does Covington. And kicking it away from Saylor. As Covington will have a return, throws it at the 6. He's at the 20. He's got some room there. There's Covington at the 40. Covington at the 45 and chased out of bounds near the 46. Chris Covington with the big semifinal ball game.
I think the best thing about coaching is that you can put young men in situations where it sort of trains them for their life, for their livelihood, all of the intrinsic value that the game brings to growing up.
So when Chris Covington's time as a teammate stopped at Brookwood and Georgia Southern, he became a teammate in different ways. In the public safety field, as both a firefighter and a law enforcement officer outside the city of Atlanta, where he's also a certified smoke diver. Think Navy SEALs for firefighters, some of the roughest, toughest training around, and also does outdoor sales for his family roofing company, doing inspections and logistics. Being a teammate never stopped.
Brookwood, the team was always more important than the individual, to the extent we didn't wear single-digit numbers, and that was the purpose behind that was you're a teammate, you're not an individual here, and we strive towards one goal, and you can't do that unless you're on a team.
Him as a whole is, you see the big, broad, large, muscular guy, and then we get on scene with a 85-year-old grandma, and she's like, oh, sweetie, and he just kind of melts away a little bit. He's like, all right, come here, man, gam, I got you. And so it's funny to see everybody sees Chris, and they're just like, oh, watch out for that guy. And us knowing him, we're like, oh, he wouldn't hurt you unless he has to. Then.
You know that when the call goes out, things are going to get handled. You don't have to worry because he's also going to take care of himself. Not just himself. He's going to take care of the people that surround him. Things are going to be done right and safe. And just have him around the station is a big lift up. Not just me, but all the guys. I could see it in their faces when he came back. They were excited. So he's like I said, he's the number one teammate anybody would choose.
And his leadership even rubs off on the newer firefighters, learning their trade as Chris splits time up high doing different things.
Workout and stuff, but I'm skinny. And so one thing that he's always joked about me with is that he said, Chris, you can come in, I'm going to get you my size when we get here. So hey, Chris always motivates me to, try to better myself when I work out and that kind of stuff. So.
Sally's at South Steelbridge. Yep.
You want to ride?
And I had an epiphany one day. I was riding down the road in my patrol car and realized I was doing a lot of things because I enjoyed them, but that it wasn't what was enriching my family's life. So I transitioned a little bit into roofing more often, got out of law enforcement strictly because of the time, and it's been great. I've gotten to be home a lot more. I've gotten to be a part of my kids' lives a good bit more, and finding that I really enjoy that.
The Covingtons' lives changed in early August. Chris came home from his regular shift in excruciating abdominal pain. His wife, Ariel, took him to urgent care to seek treatment. He goes from urgent care to hospital for further evaluation and treatment, and then they get the news. And then what was supposed to be perhaps a two-hour procedure turned into 7.
In Chris's case, we had a couple curveballs. The biggest was that at some point, it looked like his tumor had ruptured. And he's probably been carrying this tumor around for several years, actually. And when we got into his belly, we found a lot of scar tissue, a lot of inflammation. It was involving lots of other things in his belly and in his pelvis. And so it ended up being a much more complex and complicated surgery than we were initially anticipating.
And approaching that 7th hour, we got some news that he was out. And then we discovered it wasn't as simple as they initially said it was. That there was 3 additional masses on his liver that they didn't identify in the scans, that the tumor had perforated and attached to the small intestine, the colon, the bladder, the appendix. They had to go in and remove additional sections of the intestine, a section of small colon, remove the linings of all the organs that the tumor tried to attach to. and that they couldn't do anything with the liver because basically the entire surface of the liver, there's too much of the surface area that have to remove with those three additional spots.
Knowing it was going to be tough to make ends meet while the Covingtons were fighting their battle, friends organized a GoFundMe. The original goal of $10,000 more than doubled in a very short period of time. What also more than doubled were the number of folks that came back into the Covingtons' orbit.
It's been amazing. It's incredibly overwhelming, the amount of people from his childhood that we've not had, or he has had no communication with since he was a small boy, has somehow found out about this news and have reached out, athletic programs, the cancer benefit. I mean, it's people from all over this country just sending messages and testimonies and advice and homemade recipes for this and that. And some are really terrible stories to read, and then some of them are praise reports, and all of them have helped in some way because we don't know really what we're doing. It's day by day, you know?
I've got friends from high school and elementary school that I hadn't talked to in years that have reached out, and it's been a great thing. It's opened me up a good bit to how many more people care about you than you think do.
Battling this beast is going to be something the Covingtons will tackle 6 months at a time, and everyone around them sees that this is going to be something that Chris, Ariel, and the family will meet head on.
But really just his motivation and his dedication as a man and as a husband and a father, that he runs in his roofing company and he's still able to work as a firefighter. And really the most important thing for him after surgery and getting treatment was to get back to work. I actually had a phone call with him a couple of days ago where he was late for an appointment, which was atypical for him. And I called him to see where he was. And he's like, "Oh, I'm so sorry. I just got done finishing fighting a fire." I was like, that just explains Chris in a nutshell.
These days, I appreciate everything about it each day, the little things. I appreciate coming home and seeing my family and playing in the backyard with my kid. I'm grateful right now just to be able to go back to work, see my boys on the rig, check off my truck and answer calls. It puts things into perspective. You start really appreciating every day. When you're not sure how many more you got left, every day is special.
Cancer does what it's supposed to do. I mean, it has a purpose, it has a design, and it's doing what it's designed to do, and that's scary. So we're hoping that another part of science can do a better job. And we have a lot of faith in this chemo. We've seen great things so far. And he's doing what he's supposed to do. He's disciplined and following all of the instructions and the guidance. I think being scared keeps you reasonable. You know, keeps you focused. A lot to lose.
I have my moments. Medically, I'm not worried about things. But when I'm by myself, sometimes it has nothing to do with me. It's my family and my friends and the people that are important to me. I'm not ready to be done with those relationships. I'm not ready to be out of their lives just yet. That's kind of what hit me when they told me. The first thing I thought about was my kids. I haven't had enough time with them yet. So that's what scares me the most. Surgeries, diagnosis, it's gonna be what it's gonna be. But I've got a lot of people I care a lot about, and I just want to spend some more time with them.